Today's episode of the Star Local Media High School Sports Podcast is brought to you by Baylor Scott & White Sports Performance Center. Located at the Star in Frisco, the Sports Performance Center was developed with one goal in mind, to maximize human performance through movement and recovery. Their team of expert performance sports coaches and trainers will guide you to achieve your performance goals. That is Baylor Scott & White Sports Performance Center, located at the Star in Frisco. This episode is also brought to you by Allen Dental Studio, located in, of course, Allen. Be it dental work, cosmetics, and implants, you deserve a perfect smile, and Allen Dental Studio can make it happen. That is Allen Dental Studio. And also, don't want to leave out another longtime friend of the podcast, that being Texan Senior Residential Care Homes, with locations in Carrollton and Dallas. Texan Senior Residential Care Homes offers an affordable, high-quality alternative to senior living. Call now at 469-400-7650. That is Texan, spelled T-E-X-S-E-N, Texan Senior Residential Care Homes. Welcome to another episode of the Star Local Media High School Sports Podcast. My name is Matt Welch, being joined by only Taylor Raglan. We just got a two-man band for this for Monday's episode as we conclude our man. It feels like we've been doing these for quite a while now, but
we have finally been weeks.
We are finally at the finish line, the last of our district previews in anticipation of high school football season. Today is Monday. First game is on Thursday. Man, we are officially down to just a few more days.
Yep, we're in it.
So we've talked 4A, we've talked private schools, we've talked 5A, we've talked our first three 6A districts. Let's close us out with a look at District 6A. Louisville ISD, Irving ISD, Coppell. This was a very fun district to monitor last season, just because it produced probably at least within our coverage area, at least two of the more improbable turnarounds of really any program that we cover, and they were ironically enough the teams that finished first and second in this district.
Yeah.
With Flower Mound and Louisville, two teams that could not have been further off the reservation, at least, you know, as far as external expectations went, as far as teams that could potentially vie for a district championship. And sure enough, yeah, man, you had Flower Mound getting to the mountaintop for the very first time in their program history. Just to kind of give y'all a rundown of where we last left off, as far as what the district standings looked like last year, you had Flower Mound finishing in first place, Louisville in second, Coppell and Hebron. Coppell took third, Hebron took fourth. Those are your four playoff teams. Marcus, the odd man out, they took fifth place, and then you had the three Irving schools bringing up the rear with MacArthur in sixth, Nimitz in seventh, and Irving High in eighth. Let's start at the top.
Sure.
Let's start with the Jaguars, one of the more impressive turnaround campaigns under head coach Brian Basil, as they ran the table. I could not have told you like how much of an expectation that might have been for the Jaguars heading into last season. Nevertheless, yes, they bested all comers in District 6-6A, and were able to parlay that into a district championship. So as they begin their district title defense, we're going to kind of continue the theme that we've apprised these last couple podcasts, and that is reasons to be excited for the coming season. Everybody's in a happy mood right now because high school football is right around the corner. Everybody's undefeated, and it is this is perpetual optimism season. So let's talk just some of the reasons for fans and whatnot to be excited about their respective schools heading into the upcoming season. Flower Mound won a district title last year. Had a great season. Shouldn't be too hard to find something to be jazzed up about with the Jaguars.
I think that's where you have to start, and I don't think you can overestimate what that does for a program. You know, it was the first time I think they even made the postseason since like 2011, and they jump all the way from not even in the conversation to first Golden Football, you know, on the shelf for the Jaguars, and that carryover is huge. You know, just that mental kind of good feeling and vibe and that kind of desire to want to carry that forward. Okay, now we've done this, you know, we've checked off a district title. Can we win a postseason game? You know, can we go two or three rounds and make a little noise? And aiding in that, you know, not only is there carryover emotionally, there's carryover at the skill positions in particular.
Yeah.
You know, Pierce Hudgens in the backfield and Blake Short under center. Can't really ask for a much better duo as far as just two guys that you can count on, you know, in the backfield. They were absolutely, you know, outstanding last year. They come back. They should both be primed for potentially even better seasons. No question marks at all, you know, as far as quarterback and running back. And not really a whole lot out wide either. You know, some first teamers coming back and some talent out there. The skill positions are taken care of, I guess, is what I'm saying. But the offensive line isn't. You know, as far as from an external perspective, you know, they graduated five starters, essentially.
Five starters that made the all-district team, which is
and head coach Brian Bezell said that, you know, Nate Adams, he called a returning starter as a junior. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that many started a couple games or who knows. But, you know, there are some names. Senior Alex Harden's going to take over at center. Nate Adams, like I said, is going to be mm-hmm. back. They're moving Caden Wood from the defensive front to the offensive front. So experienced in the trenches, I guess, you know, knows what it takes to win battles, you know, where it counts down there. But definitely a learning curve. Mm. You know, it's a very different mentality. So they have talent, but, you know, that's the biggest question mark. You know, Short and Hudgens, you know what you're going to get from them. You know what you're going to get from the skill positions. You know that they're going to produce. You know, Flower Mound's likely going to be able to score points in bunches if that offensive line can congeal. And I think so. Like I said, I mean, just a program mentality goes a long way. You know, I expect Flower Mound to be right back in the mix for another district title. There's a lot of motivation, a lot of desire, a lot of intensity to prove that, you know, last year wasn't a one-off and just a fluke. So, I mean, if you want to be excited, just be excited about that. You know, there's a winning air and aura around Flower Mound now for the first time in a while.
Blake Short and Pierce Hudgens, last year they combined for 4,521 yards. That was the highest total of any passer-rusher duo in the area among Class 6A teams. Just Hudgens' role, period, I'm fascinated to see just what he is able to build on from last season. He was actually Flower Mound's leading receiver, and he finished 11th in the area among 6A teams in receptions, and the top 10 were all wide receivers.
Yep.
That's just the kind of special talent that
they're
going to
be good, man. They're going to be special again. And that kind of talent and that kind of, I guess, consistency and partnership and trust in one another, because those two, I mean, they have a connection, you know, that rivals anybody in the area, potentially the state, as far as just two guys that are comfortable with one another and kind of know what to expect from one another. So that can mask a lot of things, man. If you can, you know, cobble together a decent to above average offensive line, you're going to be right back where they were.
And then you've got a team like Hebron, which, you know, Flower Mound is the defending district champion. Hebron is the team that has got all the pundits talking.
Yep.
Because Hebron does have there's a lot to be excited about with this Hebron team, just on paper with what they bring back. I mean, it's a roster that, well, first off, they have more returning starters than any team in the district. I mean, I've seen 15, I've seen 17. It's a lot. Mm-hmm. A lot of carryover there.
Anytime you're up in those high teens, that's where you want to be.
Not only that, they lead the district in returning all district performers. Mm-hmm. They have 8 back. I mean, it's a team that went 3 rounds deep in the playoffs last year, and lots of continuity to work from. You have Carson Harris, who's on that short list, probably in the same mix as like a Blake Short or a Pierce Hudgens as far as district MVP candidates go. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the top dual threat quarterbacks in the Metroplex. The backfield is intact. Jalen Lott's back. Isaiah Broadway, who was last year's offensive newcomer of the year out of 6-6A, he's back. You know, he's already getting looks from Division I colleges. They did lose Trajan Bridges, who was, you know, kind of the alpha and omega to that to that passing game. I want to say he finished the year with something like 54 receptions, and the next highest total on the team was 13.
Yeah, I mean it's ridiculous. It's going to be how the Colony feels with Miles Pricely. I mean, he was just one of those, you know, generational as far as high school level talents, just unbelievable.
But I mean, Brian Brazel is pretty confident though on how they've reloaded. You know, guys like Colton Bradford, Donovan Tubbs. They get a kid from John Paul II, Jedi Henry, who's a massive target. You know, 6'4", 6'5". Mm-hmm. I mean, he's getting some Division I college looks. I mean, they're still going to have talent in the passing game. It's obviously going to mean a much different look as far as distribution goes. Mm-hmm. And you know, obviously,
always a bad thing.
When you look at that kind of disparity, though, I mean, it's obviously Bridges became something of a security blanket to Carson Harris. He's going to have to acclimate to not having that, but he still does have plenty of talent to throw to on the outside. They've got experience up front. You know, Joel Suarez and Miles James were named all district last year. Then the defense is—they're solid in just about every phase. Be it Darius Snow, Michigan State commit in the secondary. You know, they got 3 all district linebackers: Carter Norrie, Ben Rutherford, Will White. There just really isn't a real like glaring flaw with this team, which is scary to say because every team's got something that's it's not like they're
perfect.
Well,
that's what I mean. I expect Farmount to be very good, but that offensive line, there's holes in the secondary. There's almost always places where it's like, well, you know, there's you need some plug and plays at different positions. But yeah, Hebron just seems like they're just going to roll into.
Does feel like Hebron kind of checks off, at least right now, checks off a few more boxes than everyone else, just relative to what they have coming back. And we'll see what it all means. Like I said, the pieces are in place for them to to potentially do something pretty big this year, whether it's whether they fall into Division One or Division Two. You know, they're on that short list of teams that could conceivably vie for a regional championship. And hey, that's always worth getting excited about. could be a pretty big year for the Hebron Hawks. Louisville.
Yeah.
Let's talk about another. Just a you know, Flower Mound was the turnaround story of the district. It kind of almost subdued what Louisville pulled off. Which I mean, in a sense, like at least within the offices here, like Louisville's been that. I mean, first off, it was over a decade since they had made the playoffs, and they had come so close a couple times under under Greg Miller to you know to turning the corner, and just to you know to finally get off the schneid under under head coach Michael Odell, a Louisville alum. A guy who eats, sleeps, and breathes that program. You know, such a cool deal for them to finally follow through on that. And but that's the question now: is was it a mirage? Is this now? Has Louisville officially turned that corner into being a playoff regular? Obviously, now it's you know kind of like you mentioned with Flower Mound, with just this you know just the air of of change and whatnot, and how I mean it's a brand new culture. It's a program that now carries itself with the kind of swagger and expectation of okay, we're supposed to be this good. Now the question is, can they build on it? And it's going to be a it's going to be different from last year a little bit, I think. I mean, you know, despite some losses on defense, which was really kind of the identity of that team last year.
Absolutely.
I think I did the math, and they averaged something like 16 points per game allowed
against
in the regular
teams
season.
Teams that could score.
Yeah.
It wasn't like they were out there playing a bunch of teams that had, you know, bumbling offenses and couldn't get in the end zone. I mean, they were legit.
They still got Christian Versi up front. That helps. They did graduate Cadron Johnson, who was the defensive player of the year out of 6-6A last year, their stud defensive end. Christian Versi, though, had an all-state campaign of his own. You still got Earl Barnes, you know, another strong defensive tackle for them. Luke Halter at linebacker. The big question is going to be, though, how does the secondary shake out for Louisville? They lost three all-district defensive backs to graduation, and then a fourth, Antonio Wiley. He transferred to Wichita Falls Hershey after his dad, Antonio Wiley Sr., was Louisville's defensive coordinator last year. He's now the head coach over at Hershey. So that, you know, that has been a unit that has kind of been in flux throughout the offseason. And then you got the situation at quarterback, which I'm fascinated to see how this shakes out. You know, Coach Odell mentioned Landon Webster, Eric Palomo, and Taylen Green as far as names battling out for that spot. You know, we don't cover Louisville. That was, you know, Justin Thomas's old old post. I do cover Allen, though.
I was going to say, we're plenty familiar with one of those names.
Yeah. So the name Taylen Green certainly does ring a bell. And I got, you know, I heard kind of late in the spring that he might be on the move out to Louisville. And I'm anxious to see kind of, well, first off, how he factors into that race. I mean, it certainly does, you know, juice up the quarterback competition because he is a Division I prospect with some impressive physical measurables. He is a tall kid, you know, 6'4", and he's was a member of Allen's track team. So he does bring a some athleticism to that position for sure. So yes, fascinating to see how he kind of works into that mix. But he's got some solid weapons around him, or whoever the quarterback is that emerges for Louisville. You got Ben McAfee, who's back when was one of the better running backs out of that district. And then out wide, Armani Winfield, who is you know just going to be a sophomore, and he's already got 20 scholarship offers. He was alongside with Hebron's Isaiah Broadway. He was also the offensive newcomer of the year out of that district. I mean, he's got offers from OU, Texas, Alabama. You've heard of them, Taylor? Pretty good programs.
Yep.
I mean, he's on track to be, I mean, perhaps the best receiver that Louisville has had since Tyrell Shavers a few years ago. Tyrell Shavers, who went to Alabama and was just an absolute matchup nightmare. We'll see. Interesting to see it, because he's only a sophomore.
Yeah.
I mean, so he's not even halfway through his varsity career yet, so fascinating to see how Armani can build off of what he showed last year. Just excited to see if this is in fact Louisville officially asserting itself as a perennial playoff contender, because there's going to be a good team that gets left out in this district as we can get to now as we look at a team like Coppell, which everyone is all over the place on Coppell.
I mean, how can you not be? I mean, that's on one hand, you have a streak of what, seven, I think, consecutive postseason appearances, something like that. I mean, it's it's been a very notable run where they're going to make the postseason. It's something that you can pretty much bet on every single year, you know. But on the other hand, KJ Liggins, gone by way of transfer. Drew Sniglia, gone by way of transfer. They bring in Kevin Schumann from Jesuit, a transfer of their own, who, you know, respectable last year for Jesuit with E.J. Smith. You don't expect your quarterback to be, you know, this prolific Blake Short level of throwing the football. But, you know, almost 1,300 yards, 13 touchdowns. You know, very respectable. But at the same time, he comes into the program. You got to break in that face at quarterback. You lose KJ Liggins. You lose Sniglia to kind of push that competition and try to find maybe who the best quarterback is, quote unquote. It's weird, man, because defense is very similar. They lose, I think, I wanted to say seven starters, many pieces of that defense. They bring back Walker Polk, who was the newcomer of the year last year. So there's talent. You know, Anthony Black, they're excited about as far as wide receiver. Jason, I'm not even going to try to say this last name. It's spelled NWGU, and I don't want to
even... There's no conceivable way either of us are
I don't even want to venture into the territory of embarrassing myself with that name, but he's probably going to take over in the backfield. They're excited about, you know, the talent coming back. But at the same time, there's just so many question marks.
They're just so young, and it's a lot like when we talked about a 9-6A with Plano East. Uh-huh. Like, it's a team that's really young, and we don't know what that means yet because it just hasn't proven itself yet.
Yep. But, you know, I think that's why the picks are so all over the place with them. Because on one hand, you can absolutely see that this might be the year that they finally missed the postseason for the first time in a really long time. On the other hand, it's Coppell. It's like, how do you go against that kind of tradition? And, you know, we spent the first half of this discussion talking about, you know, expectations at Flower Mound and Louisville. They've had 7 years of building that expectation. They do not miss the playoffs. You know, it's just not something. They go entire careers at Coppell and make the postseason all 4 years. It's just not something that happens. So, you know, what can you say for that?
Not only do they just not miss the playoffs, they don't finish under 500. Yeah. They have finished above 500 for 13 consecutive seasons, and they have spanned four different head coaches during that run. So, yeah, I mean, it's, again, like, bet against Coppell at your own peril because regardless of how many kids leave or graduate or whatnot, there's always talent in Coppell. There always has been. It's just going to be a, you know, it's just a little bit more uncertain right now just because of the wealth of guys that either graduated or transferred. So we don't know what it means. But again, history says the Coppell's still going to be pretty formidable. Let's see. Then you got a program like Marcus. I'm excited to see what
you're high on
this
them
year.
From talking to you, just kind of, you know, around the office and stuff.
They're going to be the first team that I see this season. I'm going to go out and cover their season opener Thursday out in Arlington against Bowie. You know, for years it has always been about the run game with Marcus, and that's for good reason. They've had some storied running backs, and you just look at just these past few years with Justin Dinka and just the workload that, you know, was on his shoulders. But oftentimes, opposing defenses were wise to that as well. Meant a lot of stack boxes.
Yep.
But it does sound like there's a chance that this could be about as balanced as Marcus's offense has been in a long time. Now, last season was only the second time this decade that Marcus attempted 215 passes. I mean, traditionally, like I said, they run the ball a ton. You know, it's been, if you just go back over the years and just add up the number of rushes, number of passes, the pass-run ratio, it has been at least 70% in five of the last nine seasons. Last year was the first time this decade that it dipped below 60%. They passed the ball, I should say they ran the ball, just 53% of the time last season. And a lot of that has to do with the presence of Garrett Nussmeier, who is a Division I caliber quarterback. You know, he's got double-digit offers for schools like Georgia, LSU, Michigan State, TCU. So pretty heavy hitters are on the radar for the Marcus quarterback. And that led to them, you know, emphasizing 7-on-7 a bit more this summer under head coach Kevin Atkinson, and they ended up qualifying for state for the first time in almost two decades. And that was where you kind of got to see, like, okay, Marcus
has
some
big deal for program.
They have
too.
Some talent at wide receiver. They've got some guys that can run and catch
those
the ball
kids,
for sure.
Those kids, one, I know, appreciate that and take a lot of pride in that. But two, it's a vote of confidence for those guys to know that. I mean, 7-on-7 is, that's literally what it is. Can you throw and catch the football?
Yeah.
And I mean, it's not pads. It's not fall. It's not Friday Night Lights. But it's, it means something, certainly.
It was the first glimpse that I got at J. Michael Sturdivant, who was a transfer from the Kansas City area.
as good a receiver as I saw, just across all the 7-on-7 that I was out shooting photos for. He was as good a receiver as any that I saw. Jaden Robinson's back for them. And then they got, you know, a transfer from the Denton High School, Marcellus Lockley, who actually earned all district as both a receiver and a defensive back for the Broncos last year.
All name team.
So they've got plenty of weapons. And you have Tyson Edwards in the backfield, who averaged 7 yards per carry last year, or more than, I should say. He looks like he's the front runner to take over for Justin Dinka. He's got Tyler Gainey, who's going to back there as kind of a compliment. They're still going to be able to run the ball for sure, just now that it sounds like there's the pieces are in place for them to be able to throw the ball quite a bit more than they traditionally do. And I'm curious to see what it means. Because for all that star power in Hebron's offense and on Flowerman's offense, I could very well see a case where Marcus works itself into being the top offense.
Well,
in
a true 50-50, you mentioned the percentage last year getting down toward that 50-50, but with Nussmeier and then, still having a serviceable running back, a true 50-50 is so difficult. That's so hard to play against. You can't do either. You can't prep for either. So, I'm expecting big things from Marcus, too.
Yeah, so get excited for the possibilities of a more balanced offense by the Marauders. Be on the lookout, though, to see what happens on defense. Mm-hmm. They're switching up to a 4-2-5 scheme, so an even man front under new defensive coordinator Scott Wells. He came over from Sunnyvale. There's still talent within that front seven, obviously. Hunter Sanders, Jacob Merchant up front. I mentioned Tyler Gainey. He's one of their standout linebackers, plays both ways for the Marauders. Plus Tulane commit Ethan Barr at linebacker. Mm-hmm. Marcus is going to be pretty well fortified on defense as well. I think this is going to be a very improved team from last season. And again, some good team is going to get left out of this mix, because I don't see a team you clearly can look at, in years past, I feel like that team's probably going to be a bit down.
Nope.
You can make good cases for all these teams. We have to mention the Irving schools.
Yeah.
They are part of this district.
They do exist.
Even though we don't cover the Irving area, they are still part of the 6-6A equation. And last year, ultimately it was tough sledding. They failed to win a game against either of those the aforementioned five schools. And there were some close ones along the way, though. Don't want to just slide them entirely. You had MacArthur give Capel, all sorts of fight in a 28-21 loss. I was there in person to see Marcus squeak by Nimitz.
Yeah.
That's when I was convinced that Nimitz was, maybe this team could be a dark horse out of the district. Marcus won that game 27-23. Of the three schools between MacArthur, Nimitz, and Irving High, MacArthur has the most returning top-end talent with three all-district picks back, but the defense is going to be really young.
Yeah.
Lost one of their better returners, Blake Burris. He transferred to Parish Episcopal. Jarrell Fly in the secondary is really the only proven commodity on defense for them. The offense has a bit more continuity with quarterbacks, Trent Hardin, Dylan Fredoloso. They're expected to kind of split time at the position, plus Jose Feliciano. But they do have only four returning starters total, which is the lowest of any team in the district.
Right.
So they're going to be really young all over. Irving Nimitz has Chance Hernandez back. He was really impressive for the Vikings last year in non-district competition. But elsewhere, they lost Christian Mills, who was kind of the heartbeat of their offense, and a guy who could crack, 150, 200 yards for them. And with as much as was asked of him, it's going to be such a different looking team. It's tough to really put a lot of faith right now, and just from knowing what to expect out of them, as far as being able to potentially crack that upper echelon. Irving does have 16 returning starters back. That's most of any team in the district, but they're coming off an 0-10 season.
Right.
So you have to be realistic with expectations.
I think best case scenario for any of the Irving schools is kind of like last year. You play to maybe sneak up and be competitive with some of these teams, but I don't think they crack the top five. I think the order of finish is probably up in the air, and obviously there's a lot of pride when they play one another.
Oh yeah.
But they're probably 6, 7, 8, just like last year.
Yep. It was MacArthur last year that ended up getting the better of the two head-to-head matches with the Irving ISD schools. So we'll see what's in store there. Let's see. We can take a quick break and then talk about some of the notable games to watch and then give our initial playoff predictions. We can do that on the other side of this break after a word from the sponsor. Today's podcast is brought to you by Star Local Media. 14 newspapers and websites with a print distribution of 270,000 homes and monthly page views of 600,000 online. Star Local Media, your community voice for news. And now, let's get back to the podcast. And we are back, and let's close this out, Taylor, as we continue to preview District 6-6A. We have already gone down the eight schools in the district, so let's talk about some of the more interesting ins and outs of the district schedule, including our picks for what is one of the marquee games to watch for on this district schedule this year.
I think both of us have kind of hinted at this a little bit, but I think Coppell and Louisville is going to be arguably the biggest game of the entire district schedule. I mean, there might be a different game for district title implications. You know, obviously Far Mountain Marcus is huge every year, and that could be a district title game this year, just depending on how those two teams shake out. But I think Coppell and Louisville has to be kind of the one that everybody has circled as far as just pure postseason implications, you know, because, you know, we'll get into the teams that we think are going to make the postseason, but, you know, as far as I'm concerned, that could be for that last spot. You know, Coppell so up in the air, you know, with what to expect, the kind of tension between perennial power and question marks pretty much everywhere, and then Louisville trying to back up, you know, what it did last season and prove that it wasn't a fluke. October 11th, that game is, you know, Coppell gets it at home, for what that's worth, you know, but yeah, I think that's just going to be a huge one as far as that could be literally one that defines which one of those teams makes the postseason and kind of sets the tone for, you know, where they might end up.
You did mention the Mount Showdown.
Yeah.
That is where I'm leaning on this. I mean, obviously you have to factor in just the history between these two schools as the two high schools based in Flower Mound. But the game between Flower Mound and Marcus last year was kind of a departure from the way it's traditionally gone. Last year was the most lopsided in the history of the rivalry when Flower Mound won 59-21. I don't think that's going to be the case this time around.
Yeah, I don't expect that again.
You know, traditionally this is a very competitive matchup. The year before, you know, Flower Mound won 17-10. Year before that, let's see, Marcus won 48-45. I think given the caliber of these offenses, it could look a little bit more like that 2016 matchup.
Yep.
We've already talked about, you know, saying again, Blake Short versus Garrett Nussmeier, you know, Pierce Hudgens versus that just dynamic receiving core for Marcus. I mean, there's definitely the potential for some offense to be, for some points to be put up in this matchup. So I think that the latest installment of the Flower Mound Marcus rivalry could be one of the better ones. And yeah, like you said, could very well be a district title hanging in the balance.
Yeah.
This game goes down October 25th out at Neil Wilson Stadium. That is Flower Mound High School's their home stadium, and we'll see, man. Jaguars Marauders, always a fun time.
Yeah.
So let's round this out with the way we have for all of these preview podcasts, and that is
making fools of ourselves.
Yes. Predictions that we are sure to regret, and it could be a matter of days, depending on how some of these...
Yeah, Coppell's got sexy this week.
Yeah,
I mean, that's going to tell us a lot. So yeah, it could be the end of the week that we're both like, well, that was easy.
Yeah, so as of right now on, let's see, what is today's date? On August 26th, sight unseen, we're going to try to make sense and try to at least list out our preliminary picks for the four playoff spots out of this district, obviously reserving the right to change these when we get to just before district play starts in week five and whatnot. So where are you leaning, Taylor? Who do you think are going to be the top four in this district?
I mean, based on our conversations, I think we kind of have a little consensus for three of them. You know, I think Flower Mound and Marcus certainly are going to be vying for that district title. There's just so much talent, so much coming back for Flower Mound, so much potential for Marcus. You know, I think those two are certainly in the conversation. You know, it's going to be of those top five teams for me. Flower Mound, Marcus, and Hebron are locks, you know, in my mind at this point. It's going to come down to, you know, as I've kind of already intimated, Coppell and Louisville. You know, I think it's one of those two is going to be the odd man out. And I guess, you know, if you make me choose, I'm going to go with Coppell. You know, I'm going to go with the horse that's been there. I'm going to go with the consistency. I'm going to go with, you know, kind of the perennial expectation of making the postseason. Just seems like they find a way. You know, it, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of who's coming back, who's gone, who transferred, who came in, it just seems like the Cowboys find a way to finish inside that top four and make the tournament. So, you know, for the sake of choosing, like you said, on August 26th, I'll go with Flower Mound, Hebron, Marcus, and Coppell, with, you know, Louisville as 4B, obviously.
Okay. We do have a couple that are different, though. I'm just sold on how well-rounded this Hebron roster is,
yeah.
And I do like the Hawks to come away with the district championship. I don't think Flower Mound's going to go quietly, though. I like them as the number two, with Marcus, who finished fifth last year. I'm buying into the improvements that the offense is going to show this season, and I think they'll be number three. And yeah, like you, kind of just wrestling back and forth on whether the Farmers or the Cowboys for that fourth spot. Ultimately, though, I went the other way, and I'm going to what at least right now is the more talented overall team, and that being Louisville, with what they could have at quarterback. I've already mentioned just the stud at wide receiver, Armani Winfield, and then I was initially a little reluctant, you know, just about the defense, and then just kind of getting an idea as far as what they had back, though it does feel like, you know, with the secondary notwithstanding, there's at least enough within that front seven that I think they're still going to be able to approximate a good deal of what they
did
last
year. Well, it all starts there in high school, especially. I mean, it all starts with pressure and stopping the run, so
we'll see. It should be a fun one. So yeah, put me down for Hebron, Flower Mound, Marcus, and Louisville, and that'll do it for this episode of the podcast. We previewed everybody, Taylor.
We did it.
We got every single district, every single school that we cover, and now we get to look forward to week one. That means, as is always the case throughout the season, you can go on our website, starlocmedia.com. Every week, we will have our Game of the Week poll. We all pick five games from within our coverage area, five of the marquee matchups for our week's coverage. You can go vote on which one you think is the biggest, and there'll be a nice little special treatment on the podcast on Thursday as we preview our Game of the Week, plus some of the other standout games that we'll be covering in week one, man. It is time to go, man.
Yep.
High school football, it is here. Thank you guys for checking out this episode of the podcast. We'll be back on Thursday. You keep enjoying your week, and we will talk to y'all later.